Hey everybody, this is Carlos Ocelot, and welcome to the G2 podcast. What episode are we today, production? Episode number 9. Actually, time passes faster than a man would have liked, I'll be honest. You know, ever since I had a son, actually, time seems to fly. And same thing happens with this podcast, you know? It seems like when I enjoy myself, you know, time just seems to fly away. With all that said, I am so happy to have here on the show today the person that we have. This guy has been in esports, I think, longer than I have been myself. I've been here for 14 years. I'm 28 years of age right now. I think this man has been here for longer, but I'm going to ask him anyway. This man is Serge Kutz. Welcome to Esports with Ocelot. Serge Kutz, how's it going?
It's great, man. Thanks for having me. I appreciate you taking, you know, the opportunity to invite me to your, obviously very popular. It's getting, I've watched a few of your episodes. It's a nice podcast. So nice.
Well, I appreciate it, man. I appreciate it. You know, I never thought, it's funny because I never thought I could develop the ability to listen. But you're forced, you're pretty much forced here, right? Because otherwise people are going to be like, shut the fuck up and let the guy speak.
yeah, no doubt.
So that's awesome. So ever since when have you actually been in esports? Because, you know, in the intro, I was saying I've been here for 14 years already. How long have you been here for?
Before we had a word for it, I guess my first inkling of, like, the idea, I've been a gamer all my life, and obviously I'm about to turn 52 this summer, so been a video gamer.
You look like 51.
Oh, exactly what I am. Amazing. Who would have thought? That I'd be 52 in a couple of months, you bastard. So I've always been a gamer, right? But I would say Quake, Doom kind of got me into the idea of people kind of trying to compete with each other in more of an organized way than, like, just you and your buddies at a couch or at an arcade or whatever trying to beat each other. And then that quickly led, and I wasn't a huge Quake guy and a huge Doom guy, but that right around 1999, the greatest mod on the planet dropped, and it was called Counter-Strike, and it was a mod for Half-Life. And that game is really what sucked me right into the organized side of people beating up on each other for money in video games, I would say. So 1999-ish, right around there, is when I really took notice to the organized world of competitive gaming.
That's crazy. That's actually 5 years before I even started, and it seems for me like a lifetime.
There are people before me, right? The guys in the arcades were going 10 years before that, you know, the Street Fighters, all those kind of things. So definitely wasn't even the first one here.
How valuable, and actually we'll get into the story, but, you know, I just like to ask questions like this. So how valuable do you think it is to have seen all that shit that you and I have seen? You know, my first tournaments had 12, 13 viewers. I remember that.
Sure.
And so how do you think that impacts the way you see things today?
I think a great deal. History is bound to repeat itself, all these kind of, you know, cliches. Fantastic. You hear about regular analogy. World stuff, you know. But I think, I'm always looking at, like, all the mistakes we all collectively made, along the way, whether it was throwing events or taking care of teams, players, you know, all sorts of stuff, right? The growing pains of the industry. Obviously, we've both witnessed your 14 years. You've witnessed basically it all, too, in that sense. So I think it's always good to, you know, have that over here to always look at. I think the other side of it is we have to not live in that world anymore. We have to, as we always have, we've always adapted. We've always moved forward with new ideas, new production values, all these different things. And I think we have to continue to do that. So it's great to look backwards at what went right and what went wrong. As we often look at sports as analogies, we look at our own history as analogies, but we have to put it where it belongs, figure out what worked, what didn't work, and move forward, right? It's certainly very valuable, I guess, in some regards, but there's also people that are brand new to the space that bring a whole different set of expertise that some of us old timers might not have. So it's not the end all be all to have that history behind you, but it's certainly, I think, like, because you and I have both seen, like, oh yeah, we've seen that happen 4 times already. Why is that still happening? Whatever, you know, those kind of things. And I think when it comes to helping players and doing player related stuff, we've certainly seen an evolution of not only player behaviors, but attitudes from ownership about players, how they take care of players. Like, that has transcended from when I started and when you started to where it is now, right? In a great way, in a very positive, good way. Don't get me wrong.
100%.
You know, so yeah, I think it's good to have that that little bit of history.
100%. And we'll touch later on kind of the moves, the recent moves that you're doing in connection with, you know, player rights and things of that nature, because I think it's fantastic, even from my point of view.
That's great to hear. You know, you're a big team owner, so it's great to hear.
I mean, that's what you get, I think, from, and it's not necessarily empathy, because I have been that person myself. So it's not even empathy. It's literally just pattern recognition, right? And it's things that you already kind of lived yourself and you don't want anybody else to live or go through. But anyway, we'll touch it later. I want to get into the roots of what made Sarah Coots. Oh my God, that's a nice rhyme. What made Sarah Coots be the legendary? Actually, you're one of the oldest, and that's a compliment, by the way. You're one of the oldest guys in the scene that actually is more post-millennial than most millennials, you know, than most post-millennials.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Definitely a big kid still. Like, one day I'll grow up and figure out.
I love that. So what got you here, man?
It started with Counter-Strike in the sense of esports and competitive gaming. It came out. I bumped into a couple kids, literally high school kids on a server, and they started chatting with me. they had a clan. In California, they were coming from a game called Action Quake, and they were going to transition their little clan. Right? Good, right? And same guys, right? Action Quake 2, and those guys, it was Gooseman. Yep. Or I should say, I don't think Gooseman was involved, but Min was. I don't think Cliff was involved, but Gooseman was, I think, back there. But anyway, when they transitioned, a whole bunch of their little community transitioned, right, to this new mod. Obviously, this was the days of free mods. On the Half-Life engine, there were tons of cool mods that came out. Didn't cost you a dime. You downloaded them, and you played them, and this mod came out, sucked me right in. And again, started talking to some kids, like, the very first couple days I was playing it. You know, they typed to me. And I'm a team player kind of gamer. Like, I like single-player games. I like slaying dragons stuff, but I really like the idea of, like, team games, right? And if you want to be the aggressive guy, you can be that guy. If you want to be the medic and be support, you can be that guy. So I really like the idea of this thing being a team game. And so I asked this guy that was sniping everybody behind me, I'm like, what do you want me to do? How can I help you, basically? Right? And he's like, just watch. We were playing a map called Desert. It was hot when hostages were the only thing to play with Counter-Strike. And Desert, very small map, very easy map for the T's. They had one ladder to get up where the T's would snipe the three mountain ranges. And he's like, just don't let anyone up the ladder and we won't lose. And I'm like, all right, I got it, right? That led to playing with him for a couple hours, and literally no one got to him, so he killed everybody. And I was just keeping an eye on the ladder, and yeah, you know, it was great. And then he reaches out to me. He's like, hey, do you have ICQ? And I'm like, what is ICQ?
Oh, yeah.
Right? And at that point, you know, I had AOL, right? And so he's,
man,
like,
we're too old. God damn it.
Right, right.
Do you think people listening, like, what's the percentage of people that know this fucking acronym? So this
ICQ, man. Well, which is kind of funny because, like, that leads into, you know, IRC, which actually Twitch's chat program is basically a version of MIRC.
100%.
Right? I start chatting with him. You know, we get on a voice comm, we get on ICQ, and he basically explains to me what a clan is, you know, because I'm an older guy at that point. I'm in my 20s, 30s. And when you say clan to me, I'm thinking like Ku Klux Klan, like the clan in that sense, not guild, not team, not organization, but like, okay, what's a clan? Explain it to me. And he explained it really easily. He's like, hey, you're an older guy. So imagine if you had a softball team that you played for every Tuesday, or a bowling league you went to with your buddies every Tuesday. That's what we'll be. We'll play other teams in this game on a organized schedule. People are organizing rules for it. I'm like, that sounds cool as shit. Sign me up. And that led me to a team called UGP, Unitary Guerrilla Platoon. And
Unitary.
Awesome. Unitary Guerrilla Platoon, right?
What a, things are getting too serious nowadays, man. What are these names?
And we, you know, we had to, it was bracketed the whole nine yards.
Of course it was bracketed.
That was our tag. It was awesome. And we were actually really good. Like, we're a West Coast clan, and we kicked a lot of people's asses online. Like, guys like Moto will speak to, like, UGP getting him into wanting to be better. Like, they'd watch us play and go, okay, how do we beat them, right? And we very quickly got eclipsed, no doubt about it. Like, there's no ego here. We very quickly went from a good team to like the pros took over, right? But there was a window there. Like guys like Bombs played for us, who went to play for 3D. Bloodshot, who went to play for Evil Geniuses. Stevenson played for us. Bullseye, a 3D and Complexity guy, played for us all before they played for those teams. So, but we very quickly realized, like, hey, these, you know, are really good guys. They're going to school. There was no money, obviously, back then, right? It was like you get a video card here and there. If you got a server sponsor for your public server, for your matches, you were like godlike, right?
Yep.
So, but that got me into it, right? That got me into the idea of this is being organized, and there's guys that are really, really good at this, right? I took our team to CPL a few times. We all, you know, pooled our money, got some hotel rooms, went to CPLs, got our ass kicked by the Europeans generally. And that led me to, like, meeting the Gottfrag guys who had started their website, which was our place to go read about, you know, everything Counter-Strike. And you know, meeting those guys that were also kind of slightly older than the demographic that was playing. So I kind of bonded with them on more, I don't want to use adult in a negative term, but I was, like, one of the older guys in the room. And these were also older guys in the room, like Lee Chen, et cetera. And they very quickly asked me, like, hey, you want to, you know, do you want to, you're already all over our forums. You're yelling and screaming at everybody. You're very outspoken. You know, do you have any interest in kind of helping us with some stuff? And in that exact same time, a good friend of mine, Alex Garfield, who was running Evil Geniuses, kind of sort of just starting that, but he was also doing volunteer work for Gottfrag. He was basically running their media kind of movie review division, if you will. It was him and a couple guys. And basically back then, obviously, a lot of Frag movies were being made. A lot of content like that was being made. So Gottfrag was storing it, and they were rating it and kind of critiquing the movie. And he's like, hey, you know, you want to come help us? Just want you to watch a couple movies, give your opinion on it. And I'm like, whatever, Alex. I sure. That sounds easy. You know, that sounds fun. Because, again, I had a full-time real job, event logistics, traveling the world for, you know, doing events, not gaming stuff at all. To me, this was nothing ever going to, like, this is not money. This was not anything other than, like, helping out and having fun with a hobby I was involved with, right? So I started with Gottfrag actually helping Alex, like, review, and I think I reviewed maybe 5 freaking movies the whole damn time, right? It didn't do anything. But that got me into Gottfrag's, I'm trying to think what we were even using back that time. Maybe TeamSpeak, I can't even remember, but like their VoiceCom, right? And the Gottfrags guys saw me and they're like, what the fuck is Scoots doing? Can I swear on your podcast? Too late. You know, what is Scott doing in our
You can swear as much as you want.
Okay, great. and so they were like, why is he in our channel? What is he doing here, right? And then again, I bump into him at CPLs and they're like, hey, you want to come help us? This is what we want to do. You know, they explained how their site blew up from a couple guys just trying to cover their own clan matches to the world destroying the server trying to find all the clan matches. Because, again, there wasn't a lot of place to read about the CPLs and in real time find out how people were doing. So I said, sure, you know, what do you got in mind? You know, here's my background. I'm good at organizing stuff. I'm good at behind-the-scenes stuff. And so, you know, they hired me. Obviously, it was volunteer. And I went to work at Gottfrag for some shares in the company. And then a promise of eventual salary if we ever started making money. And I ended up, you know, doing, you know, editor-in-chief stuff, eventually COO of operations when we launched into video and casting, kind of like TSN and ITG were already doing. I was the vice president and kind of Gottfrag TV was my baby and Alex's, I'm not Alex, but Alchemist's baby, which is Jason Baker, Alchemist, who now is a lead observer at Overwatch and did stuff in E-League. But that was kind of our little baby within Gottfrag. I'm not a writer. I wasn't a journalist. So I wasn't putting scores in. I wasn't writing articles. I was organizing that content creation, right? And then shifted to doing all things video for Gottfrag. And I know it's a long-winded history, so I'll kind of try to keep going through it. So then Gottfrag led me to, during my time at Gottfrag, Alex Garfield's time at Evil Geniuses is getting bigger and bigger, right? Alex started helping 5 Canadian Counter-Strike players who got screwed by their past owner, and they just needed help getting some airline tickets to get to events, right? And he was already a helper of EG, but these guys came to him and said, hey, will you help? We're fucked, right? And this guy Ocean kind of screwed them over and left them high and dry, so Alex stepped in, right? While all this is going on, you know, fast forward a year or two later of Alex doing EG and me doing Gottfrag, Alex is always asking me, like, will you come help me? Like, this is getting bigger and better. you know, will you come help me at Evil Geniuses? You know, help me, help me, help me. And I'm always like, at that time, I was like, Alex, why would I help you? Like, I work for Got Frag. We cover you, right? We write about you. Why would I, like, technically kind of step down to just work for one little entity? You know, we're kind of covering this whole thing, man, and it's growing and it's booming. So why would I want to go help a team, right? Even though I like you, Alex, and you're a great guy, and your players are some of my favorite players, like, to me, that's kind of a downgrade. And he laughed, and he's like, yeah, I guess you're kind of right. And at the time, it was kind of right. But what happens is CGS happens, and in North America especially, the CGS brands are two big teams, and several big but not as big, you know, the Pandemics, et cetera, Jack's Money Crew, they all either fold or sell their brands into CGS directly. So 3D became the New York 3D, and Complexity, you know, became the LA Complexity, right, or the Los Angeles Complexity. And so Alex's two biggest team owner competitions in the space for sponsorship dollars walked away. And they weren't allowed to take any of their sponsors into CGS. So they walked away and dropped Intel and SteelSeries and every big sponsor that was already sponsoring the two biggest brands were now like, well, what do we do?
Can you explain to those that are listening what CGS is?
Yeah, sure. CGS was a DirecTV project. DirecTV is a big satellite TV provider in North America. Now they're owned by AT&T. And in Europe, they partnered with Sky and other satellite. But basically, it was a TV-run and produced league, if you will, if you want to use the word league. Championship Gaming Series is what it stood for. And they took and made franchises. Again, think of like what Overwatch has kind of done recently, basically out of thin air franchises, other than the few they bought in and brought in. And again, Heaton ran a franchise, like all these people that we still have around ran franchises, right? It was kind of funny. And they basically packaged it for TV. They took a series of different games and they made a franchise model. So like Complexity, for example, had a Counter-Strike team. They had a couple FIFA players. They had a couple Dead or Alive fighter players. And they had a couple race car drivers, Project Gotham, and I think Forza were the two games they used. And that was, am I missing a game? I might even be missing a game. But the idea was your franchise, so 3D played Complexity on Thursday night on TV, and their Counter-Strike teams played, and then their FIFA guys played, and then their fighters played. And then
the concept wasn't bad, actually.
The concept wasn't bad, right? At its core, they just along the way really made some really weird decisions about it, right? And where it got kind of weird for the Counter-Strike players, for example, was it was all about points, right? So your Counter-Strike team could win every night, but if your other divisions lost their race, their fight, their soccer match, then you would lose the franchise night, right? And that created a whole lot of animosity between divisions within games, right? Because Complexity's Counter-Strike team would be destroying everybody, but the other divisions weren't winning enough so that the franchise would lose, right? And it was just really convoluted. And then it gets into really weird as to how they took one of the greatest first-person shooters, Counter-Strike, they made it third-person because they felt the audience wouldn't understand, like, the direct view, and it was confusing in focus groups, and it was violent. So they made it third person. They made them play Source, which was the stepchild of the better version of 1.6. People say that Valve made them play Source, put it on TV. I don't know if that's actually true or not, but okay. They used Source. And then they did something really egregious. They basically changed the game even more so. They took years to our experience, to your point, years of the rule set of Counter-Strike, of what works, what is fair, how much money should you start, how many rounds should we play. And they said, you know what, this whole money thing is really confusing for people at home. So let's just give them $16,000. So then money didn't matter.
Right? I remember that, actually.
so you're starting with dual ops, and you're like, it was just like, what? You've killed a huge part of why we,
100%.
The people you should care about, love this game. The strategy of the money system is still to this day is one of the coolest things that separates Counter-Strike. Yeah, it's a shooter, but there's a huge economy that if you don't play that right, you won't win. Yep. You just won't win. Right. So all those things.
That economy thing makes the actual the learning curve actually entertaining for those that know how to play the game.
Absolutely. Absolutely, you know, and as Valve tweaks stuff, it adds guns and changes prices. The meta changes it a little bit. Yep. Of course, you come from a game genre
Butterfly that effect.
Like, that yeah, and obviously, you know, the MOBA games, if they do a change to a hero or a champion, obviously it can really ripple.
That's insane.
The meta,
like
right?
The way they actually balance shit there, it's like I don't know how they do that. I mean,
it's crazy.
People don't understand the level of depth that when you add one more, you change an ability to do 20% less damage. And the game may actually break.
Yeah, it's crazy, right? And we have that. Obviously, we still bitch and moan about our CZ still being in the game and not being priced right, and you know all those different things. So CGS took some really good ideas. They took, and they were also, unfortunately for them, kind of really ahead of the online free streaming boom, right? Mm-hmm. They just missed it by a couple years, right? And so their last season is when they started doing online stuff that led to the TV stuff. But the first season was all TV only, right? And it was too convoluted. They made it way too game showy mm-hmm. and less sporty, right? Like, you know, before the Dead or Alive game, a ring girl would come out mm-hmm. skimpily dressed with pink boxing gloves, and it was just kind of. We weren't even using the word cringy back then, but that's what it was, right? It was like, oh, no, like so close. And they hired really good people, right? They hired Craig and his whole ESS crew to help them run the tournament and the logistics so it ran right. But they wouldn't listen to him about rules and different things. You know, they had Lake there. They had Torbal there. They had guys like DJ Weed and Red Eye and all these different production guys. And, you know, you'd ask them to tell you stories, and they're like, we tried for so long.
I heard lots of those.
Right? And then we just stopped. We just like gave up because they wouldn't listen. They didn't give a shit. You know, guys like Jason Katz were over there running the show. Like, not a great reputation with that human being. So, unfortunate, right? I think if it launched now and it launched more, like, I guess in a weird way, a spiritual successor to it is kind of E-League, right? But they're doing one game at a time and they didn't mess with the rule sets.
Yeah, they're actually doing, I'll be honest, like, it may not be profitable. As a matter of fact, it probably is far away from being profitable.
It probably isn't. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but the work they're doing, I mean, hats off to them. Like,
yeah, they
kept it authentic. They have another one season and run away. And they're doing now different games. They're doing multiple seasons. I mean, honestly, I'm digging it so far.
Yeah, and I think one word they've used kind of from the get-go, you know, if you talk to Minsik or like mm-hmm. Christina when she was there, she's not there anymore, you know, they always, their biggest fear was not in TBS, they talk to the sports guys, their biggest fear was not being authentic.
Right.
They wanted to be, they're always authentic to their sports. They have some of the funniest, best content when it comes to like their NBA halftime shows and like that stuff. And they wanted to bring that exact vibe to Counter-Strike and then other games and keep the game authentic, but kind of bring that TBS sports spin to it. And I think they've been really successful. To your point, I don't think they're probably making money yet.
They're getting market share, and everybody, you know, many people speak about them, and they are the reason why all of a sudden Street Fighter is relevant. Like, they're literally the reason. Fighting.
Yeah. So that's CGS, right? And it lasted like two seasons, and then they folded. Right. Again, they weren't making money, you know, beautiful TV type studio, like very expensive production levels. Don't get me wrong, but couldn't monetize against it enough. Pulled the plug for all sorts of reasons. Right. Unfortunate in that sense. But, to my history, that led to Alex basically being able to scoop in and grab all those leftover sponsors. So now EG goes from like being third, fourth, fifth, eighth best business team in North America to being the number one, right? He grabs Intel. He grabs SteelSeries. He grabs everybody. Because North
also
America
Monster
wants to,
by that time, right?
Monster later. Monster comes Monster later. Later. Monster came closer to like the StarCraft II boom, right? But this basically grabbed everybody who still wanted to spend money in North America. CGS wouldn't let them, right? They couldn't take those same deals to CGS, which was really unfortunate. So he fills the vacuum, right? And I'm doing my Gotfrag thing. Gotfrag gets bought by MLG, and they give us a lot of money. We open a nice little studio in Phoenix. I move some people to Phoenix to kind of create more content on a regular basis.
Wait, so you relocated? You actually created a team?
I was in Phoenix, but
you're in Phoenix.
I brought people to me.
That's crazy, actually. Yeah. That early?
Yeah. We had a small little studio for about a year at Gotfrag TV here in Phoenix. I had a Jesuit
That's
lived
awesome.
In my house.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
Shrew and a couple other guys, the Alchemist, moved out here, lived down the street. And again, we just wanted to, basically the mission was to make content so that MLG Salesforce could go have mm-hmm. sell something, right? Mm-hmm. And they were still trying to figure out how to sell esports. We were figuring out how to make it. And the people that had were running MLG at that time, a guy by the name of Bromberg, were brought in by VC money, et cetera. And they were kind of getting, it was his idea to buy us, right? We got bought in this boom of MLG wanting to buy as many properties as they could.
Yeah.
Because they bought us. They bought Agora Games. They bought Wowhead, I think. They bought a bunch of people during that little run because they were packaging themselves to sell to ESPN or somebody big. So the bigger your media portfolio is, the more you're worth, right? So, yeah, they already had their league and all the stuff they were doing, but now they got this Gotfrag silo and they got this Wow silo. And so we were part of an acquisition to kind of bolster a portfolio to then kind of sell. The sale never came, and so they started trimming budgets, right? Because they couldn't monetize, right, for all sorts of reasons. Mm-hmm. They came to me and said, hey, here's the deal. We'd love to keep you on board. We'd like Alchemist as well, but we really got to close what you're doing in Phoenix. We're really going to trim down all of Gotfrag. You know, because we had writers, we were traveling the world taking photos and doing coverage.
Like, for that time, like an actual physical team in Phoenix, living, you know, doing content, traveling, that's fucking crazy. I mean,
yeah. And so I got it. You know, they weren't monetizing what we were creating, and we weren't hired. Like, I wasn't hired to go pitch it. I was hired to make it. So it was unfortunate, you know, that my good friend Lee Chen said, here, the road's over, right? So you can either move to New York and keep working with us, keep your salary, help us do whatever we're going to do in New York. You know, you and Alchemist, we'd love to have you. Because Alchemist is really good about in-game stuff, and I'm really good about everything mm-hmm. else when it comes to production. Okay. And I said, no, thank you. You know, I own my home in Phoenix. I'm not planning. I was kind of pissed still. I'm like, really? Kind of yanking the rug here, but all right, not my fault. And I said, no, thank you. Not interested. You know, New York is a place that I like to visit, but I don't see myself being a New Yorker. I said, you know, if Alchemist...
That's very binary. New York is very binary to me, right?
Yeah, like, and I'm just not that, like, I'll go there and I love hanging out, like, big cities, but like, no, and I live in a nice house, I got a pool in my backyard, that can't be reproduced on my salary in New York, so like,
you have
no,
to be like 45 minutes away.
Yeah, and I also, like, thankfully for me, like, I had a full-time career that I could always, like, because at that point, I was pretty much full-time Gotfrag. By the time MLG bought us and we were rocking and rolling, we were making salaries. We were paying the bills. But I also still kept doing a few non-esports gaming, you know, non-gaming event logistics stuff, Coca-Cola Olympics and World Cups, because those weren't very often.
So hang on a second. Did you actually quit your normal job?
Yes.
At that point? Okay.
Well, no. At that point, I kept one foot in my regular career with a few clients. I stopped doing most of my client work, but I kept doing some work for Coca-Cola and a few others that were like once a year. Because it wasn't, I could still do my EG work on the road, emails and stuff. And it really wasn't like Alex didn't give it, you know, it wasn't a
very
conflict.
Stressful time for you, right?
Yeah, it was busy. It was busy, you know, but it was cool. Like things were growing. The esports was taking off. So when Lee said to me the ultimatum, I'm like, no, I'll go figure out what's left to be in esports. And I can always go back to doing more work on the road for the Coca-Colas and the American Expresses and everybody else. So I wasn't, if I would have been like, if I had nothing else but Gotfrag TV, and I was younger, and this was my only thing, and nothing to fall back on, I might have taken them up. I might have gone to New York, right? But I just, it wasn't for me, right? And some people did move to New York, right? Alchemist didn't. He went back to St. Louis and went back to, you know, he left esports entirely, right? And went back to his copy repair job. He was a copy repairman. That's his career. You know, big corporate, like the big ass machines, not like these little dinky ones, but like the big ones. He did that for a couple of years, and then esports came knocking on his door again, E-League, et cetera. And now he's back into it. So during all this, so I leave, right? And it's very public that I've left, right? Obviously, it's announced and everything. Then my friend Alex, in his typical smart ass way, reaches out to me and he's like, okay, now do you want to come work with me? Right? Because I didn't have
I literally just read it. I mean, I understood that in his voice.
Totally, right? It is smarmy. I love the kid, right? Not a kid anymore, but it is smarmy, like, hey, look, because he was blowing up, right? Like, he was doing really good. I thought about it, you know, and I said, I don't want to come work for you. It's same deal with Gotfrag. I don't want to work for anyone. But if we can work out a deal where, you know, I get a piece of this thing that we're building. And again, there was no money at that point. And so at that point, I was like, Alex, I'll come help you, but I want a piece. I want some shares in this thing. And I need to keep doing I need to go back and do the old job. I need to travel some, right? Because that's how I'll pay the bills until you can afford to pay me. And that's what I did. So I started doing more event work in the sense of non-gaming, non-esports stuff, like corporate stuff. But then I started doing a little bit of freelance producing too, right? At the same time, I was doing the Live on 3 talk show with DJ Wheat. I remember that one.
Holy shit.
Yeah, it was all roughly in that exact same time, right?
That was good.
Yeah, it was good. And so between, you know, and I wasn't making any money with EG for quite a few years, right? None of us were. It was always, and you know this drill, like any money comes in has to go to the players first or you have no business.
So 100%.
We paid our players first. We paid our expenses. We traveled them. And then when there was a little bit left over, we figured out which kids needed it first, right? I didn't need it. I had another career and I was cool with that, right? And same with Alex. Like, we didn't take money for a very long time. Because it wouldn't have been good business at that point, right? So that led me to EG. I did join them, and that grew from just EG to EG and Alliance and Good Game Agency. I did several years with them, and that whole thing kind of blew up. And then, you know, I mentioned the Live on 3 show. I was doing this Live on 3 show, and I'm a very outspoken person, very outspoken.
I love that.
You know, it's sometimes like, to my own detriment.
Thought, you know, too deeply about what people would think about the way you communicate or what you communicate about, actually. I like that.
Yeah. I mean, I would say I think about it, but I accept the consequences of what I'm about to say, right? Like, I'm not an idiot. Like, I know sometimes I say shit that pisses people off, but I know I know that, right? I know the impact of my words, good and bad, right? And, you know, you make your bed and you lie in that, right? I still have yet to really delete any tweets or anything like that in my life, so I still feel pretty good about the things I do say and what I rant about. But anyway, so I'm with EG for a while, and all is good. StarCraft is blowing up, obviously. Live on 3 is a popular show. We've got other shows on the network. One More Game TV has a series of different shows, State of the Game, not State of the Game, Inside the Game. State of the Game was JP's show. Inside the Game, and Wheat's doing a couple
Inside
different
the game,
shows.
Is that still a thing, right?
I don't think so. I mean, Inside the Game was something that DJ Wheat was doing. I don't think it's still happening
State
anymore.
Of the Game is...
State
is,
of the Game was DJ... It was JP's show.
Yeah, I remember that. Okay.
He doesn't do it anymore. But I think someone's... I think there's a State of the League. There's all sorts of
State
of
It's a lot of State, yeah.
Lots of State, though. So then it got really... What happened is I got to the point that I had to make a decision because we were in a time frame and we were... It's, I wouldn't say it's worse now, but it's just as politically correct as it was back then. But, you know, we had very polarizing players, Idra, Huck, you know, that would say,
oh
very,
God, Idra.
You know,
I remember yeah. Jesus.
And like that guy, like here, you know, you want to talk about loss of hair. That's StarCraft division. And that 1.6 Counter-Strike division, pretty much.
Oh man, I remember that. As a player, I thought it was hilarious, but I didn't develop the the consciousness of you know being mindful about the shit you say. But as a gamer, I was feeling you know at least entertained.
He was an interesting player to manage, and of course, thankfully, I was a couple like we had managers that had to deal with our players. Like their job was day to day, like booking plane tickets and all those things. Right, that wasn't me anymore. I did that when I first started with EG. You know, taking care of all the Counter-Strikers, traveling with them everywhere. But you know, we had staff, and like those staff worked really, really hard, right? and of course, as owners, we're not necessarily like I can't say that Idra is an asshole and a jerk, and I wasn't an asshole and a jerk sometimes too. Like you know, like we were a very difficult team to play with and for probably, but at the same time, I think we did a really good job of taking good care of players. Mm-hmm. And Greg's a great guy. Don't get me wrong. Greg knew. Every time he screwed something up, he absolutely knew the minute he did it. It wasn't like he was oblivious to the things he said or the things he did, right? But he, just like me, chose to still say them, right? But when you choose that route, there are repercussions, and you have to then deal with said repercussions.
Also, trash talk wasn't seen as it is today. Like today, I feel it's getting slightly better now.
Yeah, and also, like, that game has a Korean culture of, like, good manners and saying GG.
Right.
Like, so, like... You're that ugly American, like you're really that ugly American in that game, right? Like it, and I didn't grow up in the StarCraft world. I didn't pay that much attention to StarCraft and Brood War, although I paid a little bit of attention to it. It's not the kind of game I play, so it wasn't really one that grabbed me like Counter-Strike did back in the day or the shooters in general. So when I first was with EG and got into actually the real detail of like, okay, got to keep an eye on Liquid, got to really get into StarCraft, got to figure out all this. And people were telling me, how bad it was when someone didn't GG. And I was coming from Counter-Strike, where like guys would stand up and like yell shit you wouldn't want your mom to hear to each other. And that was banter, that was trash talk, that was good. And all of a sudden, like, we've got 10 pages of a community being mad because someone didn't GG. That kind of threw me off, because I was like, wait a minute, he didn't type GG, and are they trolling? Are they really that mad? Because again, I'm coming from Counter-Strike, where like you trash talk, you know, certainly you don't want to be homophobic or racial and stuff, but like, you know, I just fucked your mom with my pistol, bitch. What are you going to do? Sit down. Right. It's like, it was like, oh, cool. Right. And then all of a sudden, like literally not typing GG was so bad mannered, was so bad. I was kind of like, oh, okay. Yeah, well,
different.
Yeah. You're right. So there was a climate there. So I'm trying to get on with my history so we can move on with your show. But so there was
Listen, this is perfect. I love this.
Okay, good.
Don't stop.
Good. So I was very outspoken, and I was on a talk show that was based on us ranting and bitching about things we didn't like in the scene, right? It wasn't a news show about, let's talk about this week in League of Legends, and this team beat this team, and here is the score, and here's what happened in Dota. That was not Live on 3. Live on 3 was Marcus's show, and he started it because he was really pissed off about how CGS had ended and how like all this bullshit was happening. It was a vent show, right? It was an angry podcast, right? And then I joined and Slasher joined. So it was like three angry motherfuckers calling out the bullshit of the scene at the time, right? And then I joined a team, right? And so then I realize that in my head, I have to be a little bit more careful about what I say, because now I represent EG.
You're not as independent.
I'm not independent, right? And I'm not wearing logos on the, you know, show. I'm not a player strutting around, but I'm one of the owners, right? So I got to be really careful if I go after what I might think is an unethical sponsor activation, or if I start laying into another team owner, right? Because I'm a team owner. So that looks like that is a huge conflict of interest in my head. Like if I go after team owner A, am I going after him because I truly believe that this guy is not a good human and he's doing shady shit?
Or do you have a bias?
Or do I have a bias because I'm EG and I want to crush him as a team owner, right? So I had a lot of, like, toning myself down, and I got to the point where I was like, nope, I don't like this anymore. The show, and Marcus, in the meantime, goes from being an angry rebel with no esports income to working for Justin TV, to working for Twitch, to now. So I'm like, okay, he's got a job. How vocal can he really be? What if we need to destroy Twitch versus Sapinda and Azubu on a show? Right? Yeah. Sapinda and Azubu, right? And then Rod is going from having no job to starting to get a job with GameSpot and all these different companies, right? So I'm thinking, can he really say what's in his mind, right? And everyone is always like, no, I'll keep saying whatever the hell I want.
You probably threw a few right hooks to Azubu.
definitely, right? And so I became very cognizant, and our show started to shift from us just ranting about shit and giving ideas about shit to like being a weekly news show. And if we didn't talk about the Dota tournament and just about scores or this event or that event, we had a chunk of our audience to be like, you're not esports without the fluff. You didn't even talk about the Dota event. And it's like, no, I never signed on to do a fucking weekly news show. Like, this is not SportsCenter. This is not meant to be that, right? And I started to really feel like, and we had a couple of things at EG. Obviously, Greg said a few things later that got him fired, but we hired a caster to come actually here to Phoenix to do Masters Cup stuff. We were running Masters Cup tournaments and making more content under the brands that we are sponsoring us. We had tournaments and stuff, and so we hired this kid Orb, who was an at home StarCraft caster, to come be a caster for us. Right, quickly find out that his home stream is really not that politically correct, and he really likes the N-word, right? And he said some racial shit. You know, and you know, the guys that hired him wasn't me, but we maybe didn't do our due diligence and look at all his background material before we offered him the job. Bit us in the ass on that, right? Because he's not a racist, but he said some stupid shit, right? So we instantly get judged on that.
Who was he again?
It was a kid named Orb. ORB was his online tag. ORB.
Okay.
And so, you know,
was he white?
Yes. Yes.
And he was saying that freely.
Yeah, he's dropping the N-bomb, you know, and just anger issues and stuff. You know, when people play and get mad, they say all sorts of shitty words, right? And again, I don't think he's racist. I don't think he necessarily means those words in its pure sense, like he hates all black people, but like you can't use the words, period.
All right. So, you know, one of the lovely things about having a show like this is that you get to learn people's. I'm the kind of guy that I will take a plane and I will literally just speak every single time. It just never stops with the person that I have nearby, you know? And this podcast is a way for me to kind of learn other points of views and you know, other people's opinions about things. So I appreciate this. Thanks very much for providing that kind of.
Yeah, and again, like there's no easy answer when you get.
There's no easy answer.
Words, right? You know, and obviously Thorin and Mo and all this recent stuff, they're all going through Thorin debate, you know, kind of explaining the etymology of it and like the nuance of the word, and him literally being English is different than me, right? Like I never grew up with that word meaning anything but one thing, right? Ever in my life, right? But certain, you know, countries, cultures, different words start with different meanings. So it's such a weird world we live in where you kind of have to watch what you say, but you know, then again,
very much so, yeah.
Yeah. So that's my take on that, right? Mm-hmm. And again, it's always better to be safe than sorry. Just if you're ever in doubt,
100%.
Find a different word, right? Like find a different word. And then because you run that risk, why run the risk of upsetting when you could probably find a better word that just it doesn't hurt whatever you're trying to say, but it won't bring the negative, right? You still get the word across, right? I like words like fuck and ass and shit and cunt and, you know,
those are
like
my go-to.
Just keep them real, right?
You know, I'll be honest, Scott, for a non-English native, these words, for some reason, you just default into these words too much, you know, and then you fall into the habit. You just default into them all the time because you don't have the proper word for it. So you just say you say fuck or shit or whatever, you know, you just say them.
Absolutely. So let's finish with my histories. Move on. So okay, so I'm at EG. I'm at doing these talk shows, and I'm starting to feel like I'm losing my voice, right? Because I have to be careful what I say. I don't want SteelSeries to be calling Alex and going, "Hey man, Scoots on Twitter is like going off." You know, it never happened. No one ever said anything to me. Alex, no one, my coworkers or anyone was ever like, "Hey, whoa," because they all kind of like outspoken Scoots too. But I felt myself like changing. And I had to make a big decision. I was like, okay, well, the team, one of the things was Alex asked me to help him get his team to the next level, right? Get us bigger sponsors, get us more organized, get us more business-like, get us more flushed out, right? More revenue streams. How do we take this really weird fucking team marketing model and actually have some longevity to it, right? And I felt at that time, after Monster and other big things like that, and we had a good game agency above everything, and we were rocking and rolling with actually non-team content, right? Masters Cups and other stuff. I was like, you know what? I did it. I helped him. We went from a couple of us to he's got a staff. He, you know, we've got some of the nicest decks in the business, how we do our websites.
That was a new website, actually.
Maybe I have an ego. Maybe I don't know. But at that time, I think we were actually kicking everyone's ass. You know?
Maybe SK Gaming had a good website yet because of the people that, you know, because of the users. Thing, but
for sure they had a bigger one, you know, and they were way ahead of everyone with cranking out content on a website for teams, right? Because they had guys like Thorin writing for them for years. Yeah. They were a news site and a team, which was very smart of those guys, BDS and then obviously Alex, right? Because BDS came from running a news site, right? Which is awesome. He never forgot that.
Now he's doing websites, actually.
Now he's doing websites and venture capital and shit, I guess. Yeah. You know, good for him. Always liked BDS. Yep. I wish he would come back to us, right? We could use smart people like him. Yep. And so I felt kind of in my like bucket list, you know, like, okay, I joined GotFrag and I helped them get much bigger. You know, we got bought and we all made a little bit of money. Yep. And then I felt in my mind, okay.
How impactful was that acquisition, actually, for the people that have been there from the beginning?
For which one?
I'm talking about the acquisition of from Twitch.
There weren't that many shareholders, so those of us that had pieces got paid pretty well. I mean, Alex was the majority shareholder of everything, so he would have made the lion's share of that. But you know, there weren't a lot of shares, so I guess in all reality, not a whole lot of people made out. And Alex is the one that really made out. He was majority owner, right? I mean, I had a piece. A couple other staff had smaller pieces. We had a small investor who had a little piece who helped us out in a pinch. So he got a little piece years ago. So then he got paid back for it. So, yeah, the lion's share would have been Alex's, right? which is fine, right? The cool thing about both things is when I asked for Gottfrag and I asked both Alex for shares of it, I literally truly never thought they'd amount to anything because I just didn't know what esports would be. But I just knew that if it ever did, you know, I would have a little buyout because, again, it was kind of like you were sweat equity. You were working for free for years.
Literally sweat equity,
Literally sweat equity, right? And so I look at my money from Gottfrag buyout, and I look at my money from the EG buyout, and I go, okay, well, I got my sweat equity back, you know, less with Gottfrag than EG, obviously, because the prices were different and my shares were different and all those things. So, you know, as I've always said, like, the money I got from Twitch changed my life, and I always leave it at that. Like, I don't talk about the money, but it literally was enough to change my life, right? Again, not as much as it changed Alex's life. And can I sit here and never work again? That would probably be stupid of me, right? right now, I'm trying to figure out, you know, what I want to do next. Like, what I want to do for some more income. I'm good right now. Everything's great. Everything's gravy. But, you know, I'm getting kind of
bored. And now, connecting to that, actually, you're talking about a lot of the past, but probably you've probably right now you are in the place with probably the most amount of potential impact, which is, you know, much closer to the players. It is really hard, incredibly hard, to be in a position where players trust you. And I am incredibly grateful that, thankfully, I'm in that position thanks to my career. But getting into that position where players just trust you, respect you, and for where you are, and know that you're generally a good person looking for their, you know, for good to yourself, of course, and to them as well, is so hard for them to find that when they find it, they will just, you know, grab you and never let you go. So how do you feel in that position at the moment? And, you know, how do you get there? How do your thoughts get into there? And what do you want to accomplish?
Sure. So this ties into just finishing up the EG stuff, right? So at EG, I was very player centric, right? My entire life, and I was thinking about this before the podcast, when I was in high school, I'm a short little guy. I'm 5'6", right? And so I was even a little shorter in high school, and then, you know, always thin, you know, I'm a little fatter than I've ever been, but you know what I mean? Like a small guy. But I loved basketball.
You look handsome. You're handsome. Don't marry yourself.
But like, and even at my small school, where I went to school in like Tahoe, like I wasn't, you know, like I rode the bench on the JV, which is junior varsity basketball team. So like the first 2 years of high school is junior varsity, and the last 2 years are technically varsity in North American sports. Right? Mm-hmm. But if you're a really good freshman, you can play on the varsity team. So like I rode the pine on the JV team my freshman year of basketball, right? And I would only go in if we were winning for the last 2 minutes somewhere to try to score a basket or two, right? You know, and there were a few of us, right? And so never really played. And I just really quickly was like, why am I wasting? Like, why practice? Why do these things? Like, I have no ego about my skill set or if I'm going to magically grow to be a better basketball player, you know, or any of those things. So how can I still be involved? Right. Cause I really liked the camaraderie of it, of like being with the players and the competition. Right. But I just knew I wasn't going to be the athlete myself. So I became the student manager of all my school's sports teams, right? So during basketball season, I was a student manager of basketball. Then it was baseball. Then it was football. So I traveled to all the events, learned the medical stuff, how to tape ankles, how to tape knees, how to properly ice, when not to ice, you know, and all the other shit, getting the water boy stuff, all those things. Because in high school, manager does all that shit, right? So in retrospect, out of that, I get a full ride scholarship to UNLV, which is a big basketball school in Las Vegas.
Oh my God, really?
If you're a college basketball fan, I went to school in Nevada. So my basketball coach knew some of the coaches that were coaching on Tarkanian's staff, who was the head basketball coach at UNLV. I was planning on going to UNLV anyway because I was going to school for hotel and restaurant administration, one of the best schools in the world for it, obviously, because it's in Vegas. And my dad was in that business, hospitality, and that's why I got in the event business in the first place. Anyway, so I was already going there. So, and their basketball team was fucking legendary, right? So my coach wrote them a letter, and we pitched, and I got a full ride scholarship to be a student.
That's crazy.
at UNLV. And so I spent, I left, I didn't graduate. I left because I was like, okay, well, I don't want to do this anymore. And I want to be in the hotel business. So I'm just going to go do that, because in reality, you don't need a degree to be in the hotel business, or the, you know, unless you want to be an accountant or somewhere in those kind of legal area. You know, the stuff I wanted to run hotels and run events and stuff. And you don't necessarily have to have a degree for that. It's a lot of common sense, and it's a lot of learning the business. So I got kind of bored in Vegas. The basketball stuff was great. So I didn't graduate, but I was there about 3 years. And again, that's what I did for the basketball team. So it was cool traveling to events and obviously sitting on the floor of the Thomas and Matt. I mean, because at that time, like, that was our pro team in Vegas. Now there is a pro hockey team there. But, like, so everybody and their mothers supported UNLV basketball as if it was the Lakers in Vegas. It was the thing to go watch. So it was really cool to be part of, right? But, again, taking care of players, right, is the mantra here. So fast forward many years later, I'm still taking care of players at EG, really, because Alex and I got along really well, but all the fights we ever had or the disagreements we ever had where I was like, fuck it, I'm off the call, and I'd hang up on him, were fights over players, whether it was what we should pay them, a sponsor obligation, because his job was to run the whole nut, and obviously he was a sponsor guy.
Profitable.
Right, yeah. And so, and my job was to make sure that our players were as happy as they could be so they could win and had everything they needed. And so every so often it was sponsor obligation versus player needs. And
right.
Good fights, but fights nonetheless, right? But I was always on the player side of those fights, right? Out of that, you know, out of that, I bond with guys like Jordan, guys like Tommy, you know, they all my Counter-Strike players, right? I mean, it was there were some times when it was like us versus our owners. Yep. Right. We were the highest paid team on the planet for a little while, actually. And that was because I felt that these guys had to quit their jobs. They couldn't do any part time shit. And we had to try to put them in a house in Dallas or somewhere, because we were never going to beat the Europeans if we didn't step up. Yep. Right. So those guys were making like $1,200 a month at one point, when even the best players in the world weren't making that. Right. And we also had a huge travel budget, because back then we paid for travel to events. Tournament organizers didn't. Yep. And we were going to events in Europe more than we were going to events in North America. So our travel budget was actually more than our labor budget, right? Which never happens anymore, right? Thankfully, you know. So just very player-centric guy. So, yeah, it's CSGO. It's CSGO, sure.
Production is giving us the small hints.
We're already in an hour, right? So anyway, I quit EG, and I quit both. I quit EG and Live on 3. Right, because I felt Live on 3 wasn't really the talk show it was anymore, and I didn't want to do the news show. And I felt that even if I quit EG so I could have my voice back, that Marcus was now very deep in Twitch, and Rod was very deep. And I think at that time GameSpot was the company he was helping build in their esports vertical. Okay. It was one of those. I don't think he had lost his GameSpot job yet. And so I was like, okay, even if I can be an asshole again, these two really can't be, right? They just can't be. So like the show is not the same anymore, and Magic's I don't want to do it anymore. Yeah, the magic is gone. It's not the same thing. And so I kind of and I left that. I left EG. I left and I left Live on 3, and I left EG because I really wanted to rant and bitch and moan again. And I just knew I couldn't. I would do more damage to the brands. And I had done a lot of good stuff with Alex and the crew, Colin, obviously not alone, a bunch of people behind the scenes at EG and Good Game and all that. And I was like, okay, I'm done. Like, now I can check off helping a top tier team achieve success. Right? Mm-hmm. Done media. Done a team now, done production, time to move on. And so I closed that chapter and kind of, and then actually it was several years later that they sold the Twitch, right? I had left the company long before we got bought.
Right.
Right. So it was even more like free, like bonus money I never expected, because I was already out of the company. Alex and gang had grown it even bigger, right? Which is great, because that helped the valuation. So yeah, and then I kicked around, did a bunch of freelance stuff, still do a little bit of consulting here and there, a little bit of production here and there, but really not doing much, you know. And then fast forward to obviously the big topic is, you know, almost 2 years ago, year and a half ago. Well, 2 years ago, I started talking to players. Year and a half ago, I would say, you know, a little more than that, when the PEA thing happened is when we really started to chat with players about kind of, okay, how do you organize? What, you know, what do you do here? Well, how does this work in our world, right?
And so talking about that, actually.
Yeah.
In hindsight, how did it feel, all these Shungars and TSM dispute? Was that a defining moment for you in the creation, or at least kind of spending more time in this?
Yeah, I think the PA thing really is what organized the North American players, or the voice, the vocal popular ones, Sean, Hiko, and Jordan, and their teammates to reach out to me, right? Because they had gotten wind, and through conversations with their owners and through changes in their contracts, that they thought they were actually going to be told that they had to drop EPL and join PEA.
Yeah.
Right? It wasn't a support what our owners want to do problem. It was only support what our owners want to do problem and dump this league that we have spiritually played in for more than a decade. Because EPL is the spiritual successor of Cali, right? And Cali is how we knew in North America and globally eventually how good you were, right? You went from Cal Maine to Cal Intermediate to Cal Maine to Cal Premier to Cali, right? When CPL and Cal disappeared, that's when Craig and those guys said, well, let's recreate an online league and have some sort of structure of relegation so we can figure out who the best is again. And that's where EPL came from, right? It was ESEA and then it was EPL, right? So literally, these are the things that Jordan and these guys have played in their entire career, literally, right? So they were very upset that they were not being asked to do a new initiative with their team owners, but they were being now asked to dump this very popular thing, especially Cloud9 had just won it the season that this all happened.
Oh, is that so?
Yeah, they had won it. They had won the EPL final, which, again, how often does that happen, right? A North American team winning Counter-Strike,
yeah, I mean, that's right? Did that really happen?
Yeah, they technically weren't going to be able to defend their title and all this stuff. And it was just the first conversations actually happened during the WESA leak. If you remember when Richard leaked the banner that and the secret meetings.
I remember that.
Yeah, that and there was maybe talk that WESA was going to be locked down and it wasn't going to be an open, like it was going to be its own kind of version of PA. Yep. But that was different team owners, right? And so those players, European, et cetera, and were starting to rumble. And that's when they all started their Skype groups. North America and EA started meeting on Skype groups, right? And because they were afraid that the West players were afraid that this was the end of the world for them and they were going to be locked in and their team owners were all evil and ESL was evil. And the PA owners didn't want to join WESA for whatever reason. They didn't like the pitch. They didn't like how that sounded. That is what PEA is. It is a retaliation, a version of WESA with them as ESL and team owners, right? Again, nothing wrong with everyone trying this stuff. I got no problem with WESA and what ESL. It's fine. And what PEA wanted to do, fine. But when you tell everyone that you're going to work within the ecosystem, when you're asked in interviews and all these things, and then when you actually go to do it and you contradict 3 months of PR, everyone's going to have a problem with what you're doing, right? And they did. Like, they specifically were asked, or how are you going to work with ECS? How are you going to work with EPL? How are you going to work with the oversaturation that we already have in Counter-Strike? Oh, we're already talking to them. We're going to figure out schedules. Everything's great. Everything's good. Mm-hmm. And then it goes to, nope, fuck EPL. We don't care about them. We want them to leave North America. We will take over North American CS. And then we're fine. Then we only still have two leagues. We have PEA and ECS. And their players aren't down for that. Everyone else isn't down for that. Like, and it bit him in the ass, right? So to the Sean thing, I certainly didn't expect. I mean, I expected, obviously, the owners to be upset with what we were doing, right? They had a business plan that.
Hang on a second. So you expected by default that the team owners, I mean, I'm a team owner, would be against that. Do you actually want to hear my thoughts on this whole thing?
Sure, absolutely. Love to hear your thoughts.
So here's me putting on the hat of somebody reasonable, okay?
Okay.
Which I try to be, at least when I'm not posted in social media.
You might not act it, but you think it. Yeah.
So I think that all these moves, you know, what happened with TSM, Sean Garris, what happens many times when you hear this or that team doing something completely, you know, really bad to a player doing something completely bad to a team. I think it's just a byproduct of market dynamics and lack of structure Why is that? Because right now, when everybody is fighting for survival, then people do weird shit. Like, you know, when you have to protect your family and a tiger comes to you, you can't beat a tiger, but you will fight him, right? Because that's the only thing you can do to survive. And I feel like all these moments in which sometimes the club is wrong, sometimes the player is wrong, sometimes the league is wrong or the publisher or whatever, are literally just byproducts of this chaos that we currently have. So in my opinion, anything that adds structure to an otherwise unstructured industry or market is a positive thing, because even if the creation of this players union will mean that there is direct costs associated with having players in your team, this also means that as a byproduct of that increase in benefits for those players, there will be longer contracts, which subsequently lead to longer contracts with sponsorship opportunities. Like, all of a sudden you will have a player for 5 years under your team because you happen to have him under the right benefit scheme. And then you can close whatever sponsor for 5 years as well, because that player and that sponsor, they love whatever. So in my honest opinion, it's thinking small to think that the creation of these unions is a bad thing for us, in my case, for teams, because it's the very opposite. Only through the creation of these unions, or through the existence of agents, player agents and things like that, we are going to be able to have a much more balanced system. Yeah, at the end of the day, we are a sports team. And as a result of being a sports team, our stars are going to be paid the most in comparison with our whole kind of expense rate, ratio. But that's just the way it is. That's welcome to sports. That's just the way it is.
Yeah, and I agree. And I think part of it, to your part, is like we're very quick to take one side of it, and that side's the winner or the loser, right?
Right.
And in all of these, like, the player was right and wrong, and the team owner was probably right and wrong, right?
Both of them are just gray.
Gray, right? Exactly. It's all there. It's rarely cut and dry, and when it is, it's usually pretty obvious, you know. And since the PA like letters and, you know, the actual drama of it, I've had several conversations with the team owners that were actively involved, right? Jack and Victor and a few others, and out of that have been really good conversations about like the idea of the association and what it's for and what it's not really trying to do and what it's not going to do, you know. And why the players were so upset about the PEA and And I had a really good talk with Jack. I don't think Jack likes me, and that's fine, and looks at me like I might be an enemy to his business model. But in one of my conversations with Jack, I met him. I'd never met Jack before, and I met him at the major that they won, actually.
Man, what the fuck? Cloud, it's two events that you mentioned that Cloud9 won in Counter-Strike. Are those the two events they won in the last 5 years?
Come on now. But back to the...
I need to beef here, somebody. Jack is not here, so let me just... hit on him a little bit.
Because I think what happened, I dealt with Jason Katz, right? Jason Katz was the hired lawyer commissioner of PEA, ran PEA. He was the PEA.
Previously guy, right? In Riot, right?
Yeah, Riot guy and a CGS guy, right?
CGS.
So that was my conduit, right? That's who was talking to ESL and EPL on behalf of what they wanted out of that relationship that they weren't going to get, right? There was negotiations with PA about EPL, how they could stay in, right? They said no to everything because they basically didn't want to stay in. They basically were denied every proposal that everybody else took because they didn't want to do it. They wanted, like, and when I say they, and here's where I get to my conversation with Jack, right? I dealt with Katz, right? But in talking to some of these owners, and again, not my fault, and I sleep very well at night about what we did a year and a half ago. I don't think they were told by their employee, Katz, how strongly and how pissed off the players were about what was going down, right? Like, because the conversations I had with Katz were like things like, Katz would say to me, you understand they signed contracts that allow the team owners to do that. And I go, yes, I've seen said contracts. I know when those clauses were put in. I know what the players were told when they asked about the clauses, and they weren't told it was for PEA. They were told things like, well, this is to make sure that we don't go support a tournament organizer who owes everybody money, right, who is a shady one. We want to have the right so you guys don't get burned, right? That's different than forcing them out of EPL, right? And I said, well, regardless of what you all think, and he's a lawyer, right? And he would always say, you're not a lawyer, Scott, you know? And I'm like, do you think I'm having conversations and I don't have lawyers behind us? And basically, it came down to these players will not stand for this. And if they need to pursue legal action against their actual contracts, they will. I don't think Katz ever said those words, so to speak, to the owners he was representing, right? And so out of that comes, sorry, Scott, not going to do anything. This is what's happening. And I drop a letter on them because, okay, if you're not going to listen to the legal threats we're making, meaning that the players are willing to go to court, right? They're willing to try to say that this is not valid and here's why. Never got there, thankfully. It would have been, maybe we should have. Maybe some of these contracts need to roll.
I mean, nobody wins. Right? Nobody wins and shit like that.
You know, and so we went to the next best thing was the court of public opinion, and I dropped that letter, right? I'm like, okay, if you're not going to listen to what I'm saying to your representation and you don't believe how serious we are, we're going to tell you how serious we are. I'm going to tell the world how serious we are. And we did. And sure enough, they bent on that, and they said, okay, well, in retrospect, we'll let the players vote. And of course, the players voted unanimously to stay in EPL, like unanimously, no question.
So again, I'm going to take a reasonable approach as well, and I'm going to ask you a question. So,
by all means,
the way I see it is, and again, this completely ignores any further communication after the fact of signing a contract, right? I don't know the facts of that. But what I do know is that some of these teams indeed had this clause in the contract that allowed them to push this through.
Yes.
Now you can argue that, you know, let's imagine there's no contract and I just have a handshake with a player, and in that handshake, one of the clauses of that handshake is that as a part of whatever compensation I'm paying to that player, I must have absolute freedom to decide the tournaments he plays at. Even though that may, in hindsight, not have been a good idea for the player, but for some reason, they both parties agree at that very moment in time, and sure, they're both happy of signing that agreement, right? So then, fast forward, let's say a year from that moment, this happens. And let's imagine a perfect scenario in which the team, in this case, did not communicate anything further to the player. Do you think it's fair to put the team in a position where they cannot enforce that clause? It's a tough question, and I apologize for that.
But the answer, right? Because I think in some worlds, the activation of said clause on the owner's side makes sense, right? Again, like one of the reasons the players were given when they asked about it, because people, like some of these players are not dumb and not their first contract. And like when the only thing changes in your contract from year to year is like a clause like this, you start asking why, right? Like why all of a sudden is this here now? And again, but the feedback they got, I know you said in a vacuum, right? No feedback.
Right.
So in no feedback, you know, there's always something to be said that both sides signed a piece of paper and it's a contract, right?
Right?
But any lawyer will tell you that just because you signed it doesn't magically make it legally binding. It just means you've started down that process. Like, you and I could sign a contract, and I could take it to court, and the judge can throw the whole goddamn thing out of court because of one clause, right?
But unless the contents of a clause are not enforceable for whatever reason, which I don't think is the case for this specific clause, then it would stand in court in my eyes, right? So what would have happened if the players would have went to court for this reason? There's a case to be made that unless for these specific examples in which some teams in writing may have told the players in writing again that, you know, this clause only is enforceable in situations like XYZ, then don't you think that there's a world in which, you know, that those clauses would have still been valid? And as a result of that, maybe some teams got, you know, speaking shortly, fucked from the fact that public opinion became a factor?
Absolutely. I mean, there's no... Yeah. So first part, yes, I'm not a lawyer, so I have no idea if those contracts would have been walked into court here in the States if we would have won, right? All I can say is we were going to go for it. Our legal advice was ready and believed that there were enough holes in these contracts that they wouldn't stand up, right? Whether they're independent contractor contracts that shouldn't even have a clause like this in the first place, or an employee contract that is vaguely written, right?
Right.
So we were ready. Would we have won? Nope, we could have absolutely fucking lost. We could have absolutely lost. And again, back to the point, Cats, I don't think, in talking to Jack and Victor especially, they gave me the impression that they never got the heat from Cats that I was giving Cats, which is unfortunate, right? Because maybe if they would have known that literally, like, nope, Scoot said that they've got lawyers, they're ready, they might lose, but they're ready to go for it. Maybe that letter never happens. Maybe it happens behind the scenes, but they were done. They were 2 days away from EPL giving their spots to somebody else, and they were done with EPL because EPL was done negotiating. Because EPL's negotiation from PA was literally, Carlos, leave North America, give us North American online CS.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. No money, no compensation, not buying out what you've spent years building. Like, leave, right? Like, some of the conversations I had with Cats blew my fucking mind, right? They really did, right? And it's unfortunate because I don't think the team owners maybe felt the same way. But he was their rep, and I was the player rep, right? I did all I could to tell the players every single thing that Kat said to me. And it just sounds like, and unfortunately, that he didn't do the same to his employers. He was probably like, oh, no, we got it. Scoots ain't going to do shit, right? Mm-hmm. He was wrong. He was fucking, like, the very first conversation I had with this guy, and I know we don't want to rant on that, was like, Scott, you're not a lawyer. I don't even know why I'm meeting with you. You guys have nothing to even talk to us about. And I'm like, really? Is that how we're going to start this first meeting? Really? You know, and again, I'm an adversarial guy, but not unless I really need to be. And like, he kind of made it easy, right, to write that letter, unfortunately. And to your point, yes. So that dragged some really good brands through the mud, right? Mm-hmm. But these are also brands that said one thing and 3 months later absolutely pivoted to something else and didn't tell their players to the last minute, didn't tell the world, really, right? Go find me the interviews with the PEA guys that say that they're going to open their own league and close down EPL, right? Yeah. It was the opposite of that, right?
Look, yeah. Man, I think this is the same story as I told you before. Yeah. I think this is, again, a byproduct of teams just wanting to get a little bit more from that contract. The same
I said this shit to all those guys. I go, I totally get the idea of PEA. Like, trust me, I get owners kind of having their own association, taking that brand strength, and having then content around it, a league of some sort, content, and then going to get more money. Because we did the exact same thing. We hit our limit at EG. We could make no more money under the Evil Genius brand. So what did we do? We threw Masters Cups. So we could go to Monster and go, give us more money because we're making content. We're going to buy one more game TV.
That became quite big, actually.
Shows. What?
Didn't that become quite big, actually?
Yeah, Masters Cup was big. And so we had a business where we gave our competitors and their players prize money, right? Complexity would win our tournaments. Like, other people would win our tournaments. So EG was paying their competitors money, right? But we were making content. So then we could go to Monster and Steel Series and say, give us more money, you know, because we're doing more, right? Because we had hit our fucking limit. We hit our limit at EG, so we opened Alliance, right? And originally Alliance was going to be this brain that... It never worked in reality, but the idea was you can only have one peripheral sponsor, right? So why not have another brand on the other side of the world and have Razer, right? SteelSeries with EG and Razer with Alliance. But it didn't really work because the sponsors were like, yeah, but you're really all the same team. So why don't we just give you more money? So then and Monster ends up being a sponsor of both. Steel, you know, you carry the same sponsor. But the idea was get more of the goddamn pie, right? Because you know it's a hard world, right? Your real world, every sponsor meeting, you could lose a shitload of your budget. So I got and understood and still do the PEA, and so do the players. What we didn't like was the strong arm of having to leave and put out of business an existing league to help you grow your league. And they picked the wrong game. Online CS is terrible CS. The players don't like it. Least amount of fans watch it, and it's already oversaturated. So let's stick with their original plan. If they don't fuck with anyone's world, we now have in North America and in Europe, well, PA was going to be North America. So in North America, we would have had the EPL, we would have had ECS, and we would have had PEA.
Right.
Three online
and
leagues.
And those are literally leagues, yeah.
Three online multi-month leagues playing shitty online Counter-Strike to then get you to a nice LAN event, right? We already have an incredibly hard time with ECS and EPL properly scheduling,
it's making good money. It's a hard time, yeah.
And it's low-hanging fruit CS. They make the content because it's cheap to make. It's people in the studio, the casters in production, and everyone else is at home. So it's really cheap hours to give to Twitch or whoever, you know, is your partner for you know, content. So I know why they all make it, but it's just terrible CS, man. So the fact they were going to already wedge in another league was bad. And then you're going to kill one and, like, take over a region because your team owner, like he said shit to me, like, we're North American teams. We should run North American Counter-Strike. As if Craig Levine and the guys that run ESEA and EPL are actually not American, right? But like he was making a joke like the Italians need to leave and the Germans need to leave North American CS. And I was like, you're out of your mind. You're out of your mind, right? This is not even logical anymore, right? So and probably too much of a rant on PEA. But that got us, that got the North American guys talking more in earnest about properly organizing their voice for all sorts of reasons. It brought back the WESA guys, the European guys that had their Skype groups going, because I had volunteered my services to all these guys long before PA, right? I talked to Jordan at, like, I think the first ECS final that was in Wembley. Mm-hmm. And that's when they had these Skype groups going, right? And I was talking, I'm like, hey, how's the Skype group going? And he explains, like, oh, we started really strong. We were talking about this and coaching and that. And then the next week we had a meeting and half the players showed up. And then the next meeting week we had a meeting and half of the half showed up. Like you know how players are. They get really fired up when they're angry about something. Yeah. And then when it seems like it's being resolved, they go back to just caring about playing.
Yeah.
Right. And that was the issue they were having. And I said to him and a few others that were standing there, I'm like, hey, if you ever need help, you ever need someone to give you an outside perspective or an ex-team owner perspective, like, I'm here because I think you all should organize your voice. This is a great idea. Keep doing what you're doing. Now, fast forward to like 6 months later, PA happens and Jordan, those guys reach out to me and go, okay, I think we need you, right? One other thing I do want to address is the Sean thing, because it's in your notes. And it was an outcome that was unexpected, right? Obviously I knew that when we dropped the public letter and the players knew, because that the letter was slapping the owners in the face. Like we were dragging the fucking dirty laundry right out for the world to see. That's not good for anyone's brands. I get that, but
guerrilla warfare.
Yeah, you know, you take it to the court of public opinion as your last ditch effort, and it can win. You know, and I think my letters, I think, are well spelled out. They're not full of vitriol and hate. They kind of explain the logic of why we did what we did, and how we got to the having to do the letter in the first place. But you know, out of that though came during PEA, everyone else that was not a PEA player was like, oh shit, this is what we were worried about at WESA. Okay, yeah, how do we get more organized? And out of that, it took a long time, but out of that, we now officially have a legalized association, right? To kind of have the players organize their voice and then be able to distribute that voice for whatever reason, right?
Okay, very good. So
let me talk about the Sean thing, one more thing, because it does kind of bug me. it does kind of bug me because Sean became like the poster boy, right? And Sean got a lot of shit for literally just talking to his teammates, right? And where I think Andy, and I'm not a lawyer, but obviously have lawyer consultants, and I think Andy dodged a bullet on that, because technically, probably, maybe, Sean could have sued him for anti-association, like, they call it like union busting laws in the States, right?
Okay.
Where employees cannot be penalized for organizing employers against for unions, whether it's a welding union, a truck union, the lead welder who decides to form that local union, there's laws in place that he can't get fired for that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because it's not related to doing a bad job, right?
So,
and again, you know, like, contracts are very nuanced things, right? So, but basically, Sean was given legal advice that if he wanted to pursue it, he probably could take him to court and maybe even win, right? And Sean is not that kind of guy. Sean doesn't want drama. Sean doesn't want a fight. Sean wants good Counter-Strike. Sean's a great fucking guy. Anyone who knows Sean knows that, right? So Sean is not the guy that was going to pick that fight, didn't want to, didn't care. you know, he didn't want to play for that team, especially after that. He realized that that's not the kind of owner he wanted to be around. So, you know, he ended up getting better deals along the way, and obviously not playing anymore anyway. But it was kind of unfortunate because part of me was like, okay, should Sean sue him? Is this, do we need? Because again, part of me wanted, I wanted Katz to go, let's go to court. Because then maybe we see how legit these contracts are or aren't in the real world, right? Because no one sues anyone around here. And you, to your point, like, no one wins. But maybe we would find out that half these clauses aren't even fucking legal anymore, and the other half need to be nuanced or whatever, right? So part of me was like, God, I wish Sean would have approached that, because maybe we would have seen if Andy actually did anything illegal. I don't know if he did. I'm not a lawyer, right? And obviously it's long since gone, and Sean, I think, is for moved way on, way past it. But it was kind of unfortunate, because I think what Andy did, although being an upset owner that his player was organizing, yeah, I don't know, right? There's some legal nuance there that he might have breached. But anyway, but I felt bad for Sean, because, you know, Sean is, like, not a troublemaker, right? Like, in our scene, right? We've got players that will tweet some shit all the time that get themselves in some grief, but that's generally not Sean, right? Yeah, it is what it is, you know? But I just felt bad for Sean, because that was definitely an unintended, like, negative side effect, you know, that. But when you go to that kind of war, you don't know, you know, right. Sean's not mad about it. It was just unexpected from all of us that the same way.
I like playing devil's advocate in these cases, because again, like, you know, here Andy from TSM, the Reginald, he, you know, when you're under a lot of stress, like, you know, or you need to squeeze the player contracts that you have as much as possible because you feel like you're overpaying and things like that. I've been in that position myself.
Sure.
And many times I've been asking myself, you know, should I try to enforce this kind of stuff? Should I, like, you ask yourself all these questions, and there's a world in which, you know, you see something that you deem unfair, and then you snap, right? And that's probably what happened at that moment in time, when Andy, you know, realized he was part of this union. And even though there's nothing wrong with that, he may have been triggered by it, and in a bad moment, things snowball out of control. And I'm glad that nobody sued anybody, because at the end of the day, they probably know both. They know each other. I know both. I know Sean and I know Reggie, and I know both are fantastic people. So it would have been, maybe from a point of view of contracts in the U.S., because I think in Europe we're stepping up quite well, but in contracts in the U.S., you know, to be overseen legally and things like that. But other than that, I think it would have been completely stupid. It was clearly the heat of the moment and whatever, you know. I devil's advocate here.
Yeah.
With that said, this podcast has been a fucking bomb. Like, you're good at, man. Like, your story is amazing. Mm-hmm. You know, I have actually been, I have watched your stream probably 3-4 times back when you were streaming at night sometimes. Yep. How was it called again?
Scoots After Dark.
Scoots After Dark.
Scoots After Dark.
Yes. Yeah. I love the branding with the pink. Oh, there you go. There you go.
Here, let me zoom in. Let's get a little closer here so we can get some branding here.
I love that. Scoots After Dark, people.
Scoots After Dark, baby.
So what is your Twitch profile?
It's Sir Scoots.
Sir Scoots.
Sir Scoots. So I haven't streamed in months, though. I'm really...
Yes, hit the follow button. He may just stream one of these days.
So inconsistent. It's
and then you'll...
Have, like, 20 subs, 25 subs that just... Stay loyal. And I haven't
That's awesome. So we don't have that much time. You know what I'm going after this? I'm going to check this. There's something called kinesiology. And this is super off topic, but I have my sciatic nerve. This is gamer problems, you know? My sciatic nerve is fucking me up so hard. Ooh. And I've tried everything, man. It's been like this for 3 years. Maybe it's because I had a car accident like a long time ago. And I think something happened out of that. I was perfectly fine, but maybe something happened out of that. I don't know. But I think it's because I'm a gamer. Anyway. I went to, like, everything. Chiropractics, I went to, like, everything. And nothing fucking fixes it. So I'm trying this thing called kinesiology, which is it. And I have an appointment now in 30 minutes.
Okay.
So I have to go for that. With that said.
Fair enough.
I have a lot of topics to touch upon, and we have, at some point in time, to catch up again, because you're just very good at this, man. I enjoyed this podcast quite a lot. But why don't we finish?
Sure.
With
giving
me a single word of answer, or a very short word. If it's two words or three words, that's about it. A very, very short answer to a single topic, I tell you, okay?
Okay.
So, for example, let's see. What do you do in your... Your favorite movie.
Ooh, favorite movie, Alien.
Oh, man! You know, my father's favorite movie, too. You know, when Vasquez, in the second one, suicides... And it's like run and she stays there. Man, that moment is, I have goosebumps. Vasquez, at that moment I was like, Vasquez is the shit. Like
that. And she's with the asshole guy, right?
And the asshole becomes actually quite epic.
Very heroic asshole.
I love that movie, man. Favorite show.
Favorite show. Oh man. Oh boy. Oh, there's. I don't know if I have one. Sopranos.
You can say two.
Sopranos would have to be up there.
Oh, Sopranos. Okay.
And like if you go like if you predate really old shit like TV stuff before like we had all these really cool Netflix things like Cheers and MASH TV show.
Oh, what is that?
Cheers is a TV show and MASH is a really old TV show based on a movie.
Like, okay.
Television shows growing up. But nowadays, my current binge. Is Peaky Blinders is one of my favorite new shows.
Oh, that's Peaky actually Blinders. Pretty nice.
So goddamn good, man. Yeah.
That one is really good.
Really
Tommy good. Tommy is the man, man.
Oh, Tommy is the man.
Tommy is the fucking man.
Peaky Blinders.
The Peaky Blinders.
So good.
I love everybody here watching. Just watch Peaky Blinders.
Sopranos, I think, kind of set a bar that all of them are reaching or trying to reach, you know, like the Breaking Bad. Wire and all that.
Will you hate me if I say I never watched Sopranos?
No, that's your fault.
That's my fault. That's a good way. That's a good answer.
Awesome, man. Still good to this day.
All right, so favorite esports to watch. You can't say CSGO.
I can't say?
You can't say CSGO because that's the obvious one.
Second favorite then. Oh, man. I guess these days I'm trying to keep an eye on all the BR stuff. Just to see how they produce it and shoot.
Do you like it?
I think it. I like the game mode. I think.
Do you play it?
I do play it. But I think. I think it's always going to be challenging to. The excitement of playing it, the adrenaline rush of being in a 1v100, like when you're playing it, doesn't translate when you're watching it.
Right.
Whereas
that's
a
good way to put it.
Other games do like. When I play Counter-Strike and when I watch Counter-Strike, I feel like it's easier to tell the story of a Counter-Strike match, right? Even though it's harder than other games.
Honestly, it's so hard to find a game like Counter-Strike in terms of excitement. Maybe Rocket League and actually League of Legends, I think it's gone to a point where it's actually quite entertaining to watch because everybody knows what MOBA is. I think Rocket League is actually quite insanely nice as well to watch. Have you watched Rocket League games?
I've watched a little, not lately, but I've definitely watched a little bit of it. More so when it first kind of blew up and everyone was loving it.
It keeps growing, man. That's a fucking natural game, man.
It's a natural. I mean, it makes sense that a shitload of people would enjoy playing it and watching it, right?
All right,
I would say second best right now is I'm just watching the VR genre, I tend to watch toward the end of Dota tournaments.
Although I don't know shit
about Dota. But I know enough to watch and kind of keep an eye, but I'm really not.
The old school Dota people like to watch Dota tournaments. It is what it is.
Yeah.
Favorite music?
Favorite music, classic rock, for sure.
Classic rock, let me tell you some of my favorite. Janis Joplin is probably one of my favorite.
Damn.
Dire Straits.
Okay, awesome.
Animals.
Okay, yeah, okay.
Yeah. My father used to listen to a lot of this, and for some reason, like I always felt like music wise, I was born in the wrong age.
Yeah, I had two older brothers too, so like they, they're both. One was deep into like classic rock, like country stuff, like Lynyrd Skynyrd, Molly Hatchet, that kind of rock. And my other brother is into more of the Pink Floyd, Black Sabbath, Led Zeppelin side of it. So between the two of them. My favorite band is Rush, I would say, if I had to pick
Rush? I don't know Rush.
Yeah. Don't know Rush?
Oh, I don't know Rush, man.
It's an acquired taste. Tom Sawyer, you know some Rush songs, you probably just don't know it's Rush.
Okay, perfect. But you know, yeah. when I hit the gym, is what I like the most. This kind of old rock songs, like, you know, the what is this song? There is a house in New Orleans.
Sure, sure. House of the Rising Sun. Yeah.
Oh man, what a beautiful song. Love it. All right. Oh, I love that song.
That is awesome.
Fast thoughts on World Cup as an American.
World Cup.
Soccer World Cup.
I know what it is. I worked three of them, actually. This is the first World Cup I haven't worked in the last.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Again, I did a lot of event logistics work for Coca-Cola. So like 7-8 Olympics, 3 World Cups.
Nice.
But being American, you know, not a huge soccer fan growing up. I mean, obviously, it's a bigger sport now than it was when I was a kid.
Right. Yeah. MLS right now is doing great.
Yeah. And so I never embraced it as a sport. And obviously, we had no one ever. When me growing up, there was no pro to watch. So never really pay much attention to it. And so when I went and worked it was really intriguing to me, you know, because, you know, all these European stars that you hear about, but again, don't really follow. I think it's great. I think, obviously, don't ask me about FIFA. And don't ask me about the IOC, but I think the idea of the World Cup is badass, right? I think it's funny every 4 years, people that don't give a fuck all of a sudden, like, lose their shit.
Yeah.
Right? Like, more fair-weather football fans every 4 years than anything else, right?
True.
And obviously, then, we both have a lot of real football fans in our timeline. They obviously really lose their mind every 4 years.
Yes.
Red-eyeing guys. So, it's great.
You know, my lady and my son are French. So,
I was
as a Spanish, which, by the way, Spanish will never root for French
Of course not. Why would they?
For some reason, we just have this thing. And I'm here, I am forced, literally forced, to embrace the French flag and enjoy.
But as a sport, I think it's actually really cool, you know, like, because again, like, I'm used to like timeouts every 5 minutes in my life in North America. So like they
commercial
play for so
timeouts.
Long, you know, so like it's constantly, you know, the action may be back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, and every so often a goal. But like it's not commercial. It's not, right. You know, and then, but the only thing I don't like is the penalty shit. Cause it seems like such a fucked up way to lose or win after such a long game. Right.
Yeah.
But that's the nature of it. Right.
That's the way Spain lost. So you make me feel a little bit better.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. So it's
the coin toss. Yeah. The coin toss.
But in that sense, like it to me, it's very obvious why it's like the world's game as a sport. Yeah. Right.
All right. So next, which sneakers are you wearing any sneakers right now? What are you wearing right now?
I'm barefoot. I'm barefoot.
Okay. Okay. Fair enough.
I'm not a sneakerhead.
I expected that. What kind of shoes you like to wear? Because I haven't seen you in a long time.
Where are they? These.
That's my man right there. That's the billionaire. I don't give a fuck move.
It's like 110 degrees out right now.
Nah, bro, that's the billionaire. I don't give a fuck move.
Flip flops. Now, obviously, when I'm out and about, I'm not. Well, here locally, but if I do events, I don't know.
You have to let me romanticize with your outfit. Right. Let me just say, it's the billionaire. I don't give a fuck move.
All right, fair enough.
All right. I actually don't know this. Do you have any children?
I do not. I'm single.
Okay.
Divorced. I was married for quite a while, but no, we never had, never got around to kids. We were both too busy, her and I, figuring out what we wanted to be when we grew up, and we never got around to it in the sense of like, we want to travel, we want to do this. Yeah. And so,
fair enough.
And then,
if it serves as any context, when you have children, you play less. That's mathematical.
Yeah, I can imagine. way less.
All right, so I've seen this T-shirt that you were in about the Gamers Outreach Foundation.
Yeah.
In which ways do you work with them?
I'm on what's
actually. Let's go a step behind for the people that are watching. What is this?
Okay, so Gamers Outreach is a charity that raises money to build and then provide medical grade gaming carts for children's hospitals. You know, an Xbox or a PlayStation monitor, a whole like medical grade antibacterial like cart that the nurses can roll into a kid who's sick in a hospital and he can play video games, right? So we raise money to build the carts to then deliver to hospitals.
Where can people go to help the cause?
Gamersoutreach.org is the main website. I'm what's called the development council, which is just an advisor to help figure out ideas to to bring in more money.
That's awesome.
You know, how do we get more streamers involved? You know, those kind of things.
Good for you, man. Good for you.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you guys really have cool. any doubt, just tweet at Mr. Surskut, which will have the tweet handle probably in the overlay.
It's a really cool charity. And I think one of the coolest things about it, like, we have tons of cool gamer charities in our space, you know, Child's Play and all Operation Supply Drop, all sorts of cool ones, right? And I liked this one because, like, I raised X amount of money and I literally gave it to Gamers Outreach. And then they said, where do you want these carts to go?
That's awesome.
I could pick my hospital. And then I went to my hospital here in Phoenix carts to deliver it, right? So you have that. It's not just like, here's a check. You can just donate, but like Summit had a fundraiser. He made like 10 carts for a hospital in Colorado Springs and then got to deliver it. So if you're the guy that raised the money, you kind of get the feel back. You can see your thing in use, right? And the good it does. So it's just a really cool charity. So yeah, check it out. Or hit me up on Twitter if you're interested. Yeah, really cool stuff. And we're trying to get it into Europe too. Yeah. I mean, right now it's mostly North American hospitals, but we're trying to figure out how do we get these to Europe. You know, change the power supplies so they work in what countries, and how do we get them over there, and all those kind of things. Because again, there's sick kids in hospitals all around the world, right?
Right.
That's the plan, basically, is get these things everywhere.
Yep, absolutely. Your stream, quick thoughts.
My stream,
yay,
is non-existent right now. Unfortunately, I'm just lazy, right? I just don't. I go through peaks and valleys of being interested in games, so I'll spend a week where I don't play anything, and I'm just fucking around doing other shit. So then I don't want to stream something I'm not interested in playing, right? So I don't approach it properly, right? Which is
so how do you like having fun nowadays that you don't stream?
I'm playing a lot of games with friends, a little bit of travel, going to events, you know, keeping an eye on social media. I tweet for fun. People seem to think I get really mad when I tweet, but generally I'm laughing when I'm tweeting.
I know you don't. That's the thing. Like, but yeah.
You know, people are like, he's so triggered. I'm like, no, trust me. This is funny to me. This is not angry for me. This is not laughing.
They don't get it.
Yeah, you know. My elderly mother takes care of me, lives with me, so I take care of her. Kind of full circle of life happening here in Phoenix. I keep myself pretty busy, but beautiful. I'm also, I would say, pretty lazy. Like, I'm trying to figure out what I want to do again. Like the player association thing is awesome, and it's now up and running, and we got legal help and guys running day-to-day stuff in Denmark, which is awesome. I know we didn't talk about much of the nuts and bolts of the CSPPA. Maybe we'll have another show where we really dive into that.
Absolutely.
But eventually, like, and what my official role for them is, I'm advisor and consultant to the board of players and the association itself. Eventually, but that's not something that I will do. Like, I'm not looking to the association for a job. But so eventually I will sink my teeth back into a business in esports and do something again. I don't know what it is yet, right? It'll be after I move away from the CS thing, because I don't want to do anything now. Because people ask me all the time, hey, will you help me with this? You want to do this? You want to do that? And it's always like, no. A, I want to own it, and you're not going to give me the ownership I want. And B, I don't want to do anything that's a conflict of interest in anyone's eyes of helping the players right now, right?
And so, right now, the last thing you can do is to work with a team, because...
Right. Or even work more so with a tournament organizer that might be one that does CS stuff, right? Because I need to be agnostic right now, because my job is to be that, right? And eventually players will be up and running. They won't need my voice. They won't need my help. And then, you know, I will dip back and do something else. I don't know if that'll be a year from now, 2 years from now, who knows, right? But I'm having a great time doing not very much right now. That's for sure. It's kind of nice. Because I also spent decades busting my ass, right? So while I've been retired for a few years,
fair enough,
I grinded for fucking ever.
Fair enough.
So yeah.
And the last one, quick thoughts on the betting catastrophes. We're talking about Usual Suspects.
Yeah. You want to phrase that in more of a question, or
like... yeah? Quick thoughts on Phantom Lord, for example.
I mean, Phantom. I'm not a fan of Phantom Lord, right? Nor how he conducts himself, nor how he, what I would say, takes advantage of his fan base, right? I don't think he's a very ethical human being. I think it's been kind of proven. So, unfortunately, maybe he hasn't had the repercussions that he should have had to learn some lessons. It's unfortunate, because I just don't think he's one of those up and up individuals, right? Teach their own, you know. Buyer beware. If you're gonna give someone like that money, like, shame on you, right? I ain't giving him any money. Gambling in general is kind of funny because everyone thinks I hate it. Everyone thinks that like I'm really anti-gambling and that I'm because I made a stink several years ago when CSGO Lounge was, you know, letting kids skins and stuff. I am absolutely opposed to underage gambling, as any human should be.
Mm-hmm, of course.
And our problem, to your point of like Wild West, no regulation, all of these things happen in this vacuum of proper regulation, if you will, proper policies of stuff. I think gambling on esports is here and will continue to be here and is absolutely essential and lucrative to the continued growth of it. Pro sports would not be anywhere near as popular and as big if there wasn't legal betting and illegal betting on the games, right? Bookies and the mobsters, you know, that drives people watching. And now sports books and casinos, that drives people being more engaged in watching sports or reading about them so they get the info, right? Now, are they into the game because they love football, or are they into football because they bet on it and they're into the bet and winning money? Probably the second one for some people, but that's fine because they're still there. They're still being advertised to and all people, that.
It absolutely does. Well, this was really perfect. I enjoyed myself so very much. I learned about you and how you think about the industry, and I learned quite a lot, actually. So thanks very much for being here.
Good. I'm glad to be here, man. Thanks for having me. Let's do it again.
Absolutely. Count on it, man. And best of luck with everything you're working on. Best of luck with Gamers Outreach Foundation. Reach out to me if there's anything we can do to help. And
that's great.
Okay, man. Appreciate it.
No worries.
And for everybody out there that have watched the show, maybe in full, maybe partially. If you haven't watched it in full, you have to watch it in full. I mean, this was pretty good. Thanks very much for watching, people. We love you so very much. And that's my classic sellout outro. What I do is that I give you an outro with sellout, and then I placed an outro with more sellout. So it's like double sellout. And that just gets into your brain, and you have to buy G2 merchandise. So why don't you guys head into g2esports.com/shop and buy everything? I don't think you can actually buy this katana, but we have to maybe change that. Production, can we get a fucking katana on the shop?
Over
they 80. Said yes. They said yes. Maybe not today, but a katana is getting on the fucking shop. We love you, people. Roll the outro.